So one of the most powerful things that we can do is to learn about the nature of our mind. And what I mean by that is not about the construction of our mind, not about necessarily the psychology of the mind, but just the tendencies of the mind, which are somewhat wild. We never quite know what our minds are going to do or what they're going to present to us. And so when we learn about the different types of thoughts we have, for example, we have thoughts about the future. We have thoughts about the past. When we learn about those and we come to expect them, then we're not as surprised. We're not as prone to become upset by what our mind presents us, and we can take it in stride. And that's just one of the ways that we can evolve past our current state into a state of greater peace and greater productivity.
Your mind is an amazing and beautiful resource. It's vastly complex and capable of virtually limitless ideas, thoughts, and beliefs. Your mind represents the pinnacle of evolution as we know it. The creative capacity of the human mind is what has allowed us to survive and thrive, but it's also what causes many of us to suffer needlessly because we have yet to develop the awareness and the skills needed to manage the flow from our imaginations.
Welcome to this episode of Evolve, an exploration of spirituality, wellness, and the thoughtfulness practice with acclaimed author and visionary teacher, Kalani Das.
As a human being, you have the ability to generate vast amounts of ideas, form designs, build things, and shape your environment and the world in which you live. The potential for both creation and destruction is self-evident as we look out into the world of mankind. It becomes obvious that humans are both creating and destroying at the same time. The challenge that lays before us is to use our capacity for creation in ways that do not damage our environment. Few people would dispute the intrinsic beauty and value in the natural landscape. Some might even argue that there's very little that man can do to improve the beauty and value of the natural world. From the stillness before the dawn to the sights and sounds that unfold across our natural landscape each and every day, and the sacred majesty of the night sky, our world is filled with miracles, beauty, and occasions for experiencing a childlike wonderment, a feeling of magic and spirituality. Our quality of life is increased with technology that preserves our safety and feeds our minds and bodies, but that also leaves the natural landscape undamaged. During this great awakening, humans are faced with crucial choices with regard to how they are managing their resources. Similarly, if we turn our attention towards the individual, we see a parallel of both resources and options. Each of us is endowed with a natural beauty, with gifts and talents and a potential for creativity and productivity. Just as we observe beauty in the natural landscape, we can observe the same power and beauty in ourselves. And just as humans as a race must learn to balance impulses and needs with the responsibility of caring for the environment, it's up to the individual to find the best ways to nurture his or herself while at the same time not harming the natural beauty and spirit that lies within each of us. this beauty and spirit is a constant, and there's little that anyone can do to reduce it. It is in how we live, the choices we make each day, and the ways we learn to manage that flow of creativity that can determine the quality of our lives. If we are to evolve our minds, and as a result, the potential quality of our lives both on a physical and spiritual level, then it stands to reason that we must develop both an understanding of and an ability to use our minds in ways that are going to help us reach our goals of satisfaction, contentment, and happiness. In order to do that, the first step is to become familiar with both the nature of the mind and its role with regard to achieving your physical, emotional, and spiritual goals. It might be helpful to start by thinking of your mind not as yourself, but as your helper or your assistant. After all, your mind or your thinking is simply the product of the work of your brain, which is just an organ in your body. When we refer to the mind, what we're talking about is the activity of the brain, which is usually experienced as a multitude of what we often describe as thoughts, notions, memories, images, sounds, and so on. Of course, the content of the mind is largely a product of internal thinking and is therefore subjective. We each form our reality through the filter of the mind, which is why people often form very different realities when presented with what is essentially the same information. The nature of your mind is to create. As mentioned earlier, your mind is a vast resource. It's a tool that you are meant to use to store and retrieve and cross-reference information. You use your mind to make connections between things that are both related and sometimes unrelated. You use your mind to come up with solutions to puzzles and problems. You can also use your mind to create works of art. But it's important to understand that your mind is not simply like a computer that you can program and turn on and off anytime you wish. It takes only a few minutes of observing the product of one's mind to come to the conclusion that it's a dynamic force. The mind is, in many ways, like the weather, changing from moment to moment, and it's not something that can necessarily be controlled, but that must be observed and respected for its depth and power. Your mind is like a wild animal. It's as wild and powerful as nature itself. It is the wildness and dynamism of the mind that gives us the potential for creating art, solving complex problems, and developing cutting-edge technology. But it's also the same characteristics that can cause confusion and suffering in those who are not skilled in determining which thoughts will be the most useful and which can be released back into the wild. Anyone with a mind knows that it's absolutely true that every human has a wide variety of thoughts, thousands every day. Scientists and doctors have done a wonderful job identifying and mapping the elements and functions of the mind, but one needs only to observe the mind from the perspective of a user in order to achieve an intimate understanding of its nature. Everything you need to know is available for you to know if you pay attention. There's nothing hidden in the universe. The key to forming a peaceful and productive relationship with your mind is to be able to recognize the qualities and characteristics of the many thoughts that you entertain each day. The reason it's important to understand the thought type is that it determines whether or not that thought will be useful, and if it is useful, how you will use it. The difference between a person who is content and productive versus someone who is anxious and struggling is largely in how they are managing the flow of thoughts they are being presented with from moment to moment. The mind may present a scenario that could occur in the future as a way of trying to help foresee a potential problem. The individual who is unskilled in recognizing and managing that particular thought type might be tempted to follow it even farther down that line of thinking and may end up experiencing it as real on some level. When the thought becomes potent enough so it is perceived as a viable and real situation, it's likely that the body will react with a fight, flight, or freeze response, which includes the release of certain stress hormones, tensing of muscles, quickening of breath, and so on. This physical response can cause damage, both physically and psychologically. The individual who is in his or her practice allows all thought types to be presented to the mind. They will simply acknowledge them and take note, but because those thoughts are one of many possibilities, they are not given as much weight as what is happening in the present moment. Nor are they taken as seriously as the vision that the individual holds, which is aimed at successfully reaching his or her goals. The practicing individual recognizes the thought as a possible but improbable outcome. They see the thought for what it is, a presentation by the mind to illustrate a possibility. The person who is in his or her practice takes note of the thought and may even take some form of action to mitigate the possibility of that scenario occurring in the future. But what they don't do is treat it as if it is happening. They know that if the thought gains momentum and body, that it could potentially do real and ongoing physical, emotional, and even spiritual harm. They experience the thought as one of many possibilities, not as a probable reality. This type of thinking is what is meant by the advice, "Don't believe everything you think." One of the first skills you will develop in your thoughtfulness practice is to begin to recognize the different thought types that you will have throughout the day. There are many types of thoughts, and I will discuss those in greater detail in the future. One of the basic ways you can start to identify your thought types is by time. This includes thoughts about the past, thoughts about the present, and thoughts about the future. Of course, all of your thoughts happen in the present moment, or the now. However, our focus is on the content of the thought as it relates to your life experiences. If your thought is about something that happened in the past, say to yourself, "Thinking about the past," or simply, "past." Similarly, if your thought is about something that might occur in the future, say to yourself, "Thinking about the future," or "future." The rest of your thoughts will automatically fall into the category of the present. Many people find that reducing the amount of time spent thinking about the past or future can have a positive effect with regard to feelings of contentment. Noticing your own thought types will help you in shaping a way of being that supports your goals. Another thought type that may be useful for you to begin to note is that of the repeated thought. It's very common for people to have the same or similar thoughts throughout the day, and even over a period of weeks or months. If this type of thinking is something you might want to change or reduce, you'll need to begin to pay attention to how often and under what circumstances you have repeated thoughts. When you find yourself entertaining a repeated thought, say to yourself, "Repeated thought." This labeling of thoughts may seem mechanical and even unintuitive at first, but it serves an important purpose, which is to give you an objective view of your own thought patterns and tendencies. Once you get an idea of where you are now with regard to your current thinking, you can form a plan and a practice to take you to where you want to be in the future. Changing your relationship with your own thinking can be one of the most fruitful investments you will ever make. Keep in mind that meaningful change often happens in very small increments, but it does happen. It takes time and it takes commitment. Take a few moments to thank yourself for making the commitment to improve your relationship with your own mind. You are learning to ride the winds of your mind without getting swept away in the flurry of activity. If you like, meditate on this affirmation. My mind is a creative and dynamic resource designed to help me achieve my goals. My mind is a creative and dynamic resource designed to help me achieve my goals. Future talks will be aimed at deepening one's capacity for self-awareness, sensing and using feelings to liberate the mind and body, and forming a friendly relationship with the mind, one that helps you reach your goals in work and at play.
You've been listening to Evolve with author and teacher Kalani Das. Visit KalaniDas.com, where you'll enjoy inspirational music, insightful articles, and other resources as you continue to evolve.